a temporary state of quiet and calm, and then go back to being disturbed and upset or confused, but to equalize it so that more and more the nature's in samadhi all the time. This is the longer goal. And when that happens, then the distinctions of inside and outside self and others, the temple and the world, all that just sort of breaks down, and every place is the same place and every time's the same time. So that's the idea called nature and samadhi. I'm going to ramble some more. I remember when I first came into the monastery, this was back in the 75, 76, people were doing what you were doing tonight, and I thought, how silly and stupid. They're not doing anything. I want to go someplace where I can learn and get enlightened. And everybody was just sitting there with their legs crossed, doing nothing. I dismissed it as simplistic, and I was above that. And yet, the first time I tried to do it, I realized that of all the things I had ever done, this was indeed the most difficult. And that was sobering and humbling in itself, because what I had dismissed as a simple practice turned out to be immensely complex. Not just the physical part of sitting, and those of you who tried it, just to do the posture right, to sit with the spine straight and follow all the physical instructions of relaxing and breathing properly and so forth, and doing that for an hour is an accomplishment itself. Some of you know this, right? Okay. But then you go to the next stage. Well, once you got that, then you calm the mind, right? And I had no idea what that was about. And I figured I would just do what everybody else did. So I sat there like that. And the mind did not calm. In fact, it got worse. It got more agitated. And then I found out that happened to everybody. So while everybody was paradoxically sitting there calm and still, the mind had accelerated to warp speed with all of the things that are going on. And some of you may have experienced this too, or not. Right, good. Good, I say, because that's what my teacher said. And I said, well, why is this good? He said, because it's like this all the time, but you never know it until you stop. And so knowing it is the first step to your awakening, which was kind of disappointing, because it was a garbage can full of stuff. And it was like a television you couldn't turn off, just going nonstop. And I thought it would be just simple as, holding your breath, stopping your mind, and you get awakened. And he said, well, actually, stopping your mind is much more complicated than it seems, and yet it's the simplest thing to do. Just stop grabbing at stuff. Stop grasping. Oh, I thought, well, that's as simple. He says, if you can't let go of what's false, you won't be able to pick up what's true. If you can't stop grasping, you won't get clarity and you won't see things as they really are. And he gave a verse then, and the verse was, it started the session, I've said it to you times before. He says, living beings, ordinary people, grasping everywhere, cover over the wondrous, cover over the wonderful, the wondrous, meaning the awakened intrinsic nature. And then the next two lines, let go, release your hold, the wondrous revealed. So it was a formula. And the formula was, we cover over whatever it is that's really wondrous about being human to the deepest sense by grasping. And if you stop the grasping, you don't then have to go seek for the wondrous. It manifests by itself. So the paradox is, it's striving to manifest, but we cover it over by this frantic activity, grasping everywhere. Now, the reason I came in to the monastery, in a sense, many reasons, but one was I started to see the primacy of mind, or the primacy of the mind. I don't know, does that make sense to you at all? People ask, well, what's the primary defining factor of human affairs? And some people say, well, it's economics, or it's politics, or war, What's the determining factor of human history? But what Buddhism is arguing, and I think I saw before I was a Buddhist, was everything indeed was coming from the human mind. That all the institutions, not just the physical structures, architect and roads and whatnot, were first brought up through the mind, but all of the things in our relationships, all that we long for, dream about, think about, and whatnot, are activities of mind. And partly this came because at this time, before I came in, I was working in the Central Valley of California with severely emotionally disturbed children. I don't know what they call children nowadays. That was the politically correct term then, SEDs. They used to call them, let's see, delinquents, misfits, malcontents. And then they had more derogatory terms for retarded. What's some of the other terms they used? Going back, huh? Spastic was more of a physiological thing. No, they weren't mentally slow. They were actually pretty fast. That's why they were a problem. But they used emotionally disturbed because they didn't want to use psychoanalytical terms like psychotic or neurotic or schizophrenic or whatnot. But they were really troubled problem kids. These were the kids that were burning down shopping malls, shooting people, stabbing people, abusing themselves, abusing others. Let me see if I could run through the list of why we got them. And so we were, at the time, liberal and progressive, and so what we did, normally they locked the kids up and put them in institutions, and they figured out that this wasn't working. It wasn't causing any changes. In fact, they came out just institutionalized. And if they stayed in long enough, they never came out. They became totally institutionalized, which means they became so afraid of the outside world that they just wanted to stay in the institution. So the institutions were swelling with people who were on drugs to keep their behaviors down and then never wanted to leave the institution. So what we did is we would buy a house in, this was in Modesto, and then we would get six of these children given to us through the state or the county, referred through the system, that were extremely emotionally disturbed. And we'd live together in the house as a family. So we created a non-institutional, more or less, setting. And then we tried to work with these kids to get them back and functioning in society. And it was remarkable. By dropping the institutional thing, they responded, but on the other hand, since we didn't have any keys and doors and bars or anything like this, sometimes we were at our wits' end. chairs flying through windows, and I won't go into some of the more graphic details. Let your imagination rest here. Anyway, we started working with the children. We used a number of different therapies, and amazingly, at that age, children are resilient and can change and become different and better. And so within 6-7 months, sometimes longer, we would get these kids back into being pretty healthy, normal kids. A lot of love, a lot of attention, a lot of boundaries and, you know, behavioral psychology and so forth. We used a lot of different things, but it worked. And then we would then put them back into their families that had not had, in California it was called, had lost or were not exercising control over the children. The children were out of control. The parents were fine, they had done their best, but that was the theory. So put the kids back in the home, and we started noticing 3 or 4 months later, these kids would be back again, totally messed up. And we're going, what happened? And the parents said, your medicine didn't work. Try it again. And after a while, we began to go, duh, maybe it's not the kids, it's the parents. You know, this was counterintuitive at the time. So what we decided to do, we were pretty cutting edge, I guess, for the time. Moreover, the neighborhood noticed us because we moved into regular residential neighborhoods, you know, with Ozzie and Harriet and their kids and on Gleam Street. And we had some rowdy kids just running around the neighborhood. And we booked them into the school system. We took them to the county fair. We went to the YMCA swimming with them. And, you know, one of the kids would just take out their suit and jump on into the water nude. And you'd have to, no, Jimmy, come on out. You have to put your suit on, you know. Another kid would shove another kid and hold him under the water, you know, and the mother would be screaming, he's drowning my son. Okay, stop, you know. So it wasn't all smooth in the neighborhood. So what we did was, after a while, we said, let's do observation. So we went to the homes. And our practice was to sit in the homes for 2 weeks or longer now, and just observe. We became like this. We didn't interact with anybody. You ask us a question, we wouldn't say anything. You give us something, we wouldn't take anything. We were like not there, but we were there. And this was part of the method that we were developing. And so the first 3 or 4 days, everybody was stellar on their best behavior. Everything was really good. But after a while, we started to be like the lamp in the corner, and they didn't notice it anymore. And then you started to see the patterns of behavior coming out. And sure enough, everything these kids were doing was taught and reinforced and brought on by the parents, not the kids themselves. Wow. So that was quite an insight. And we realized, okay, then we have to not so much treat the children, but treat the parents. And that led to a whole development of a program of teaching parents how to be parents. Well, in teaching parents how to be parents, pretty soon you're finding that they were just doing things that their parents had done to them and were acting habitually and reflexively from their own thoughts and emotions and feelings, which they never examined. And it became pretty clear that you'd have to go to pretty much deeper ground here to get a handle on this. You'd have to go into the very nature of the human mind and how it worked. And at that point, there was no further we could go with it, because to work with these people meant that they would have to get into a level of understanding and knowing themselves, being aware, self-reflective, watching how things worked in their minds and so forth. And by the time they were 40, 30, 50 years old, it was pretty hard to work with. But in a sense, it was the primacy of the mind that impressed upon me that these kids were products of their parents' minds, literally at every step. And so that everything we saw going on around us in society goes back to the mind and what's going on in the mind. So that I thought, well, Buddhism is a logical thing to look into here because that's the study and the understanding of the mind. So it was from that concern, partly, that I ended up being attracted to Buddhism. But then, coming in with my teacher, his teaching seemed to be that everything was okay, everything was fundamentally no problem, and that all of the difficulties, all of the snarls we got ourselves into were coming out of the workings of the mind, unexamined, uncultivated, even unconscious. And so for the early part and a lot of the practice of meditation had to do with not so much developing an enlightened or awakened mind, but really uncovering all those aspects that were entangling it or covering it over. So it was a reverse movement. And that's why he would make a statement like, let go, release your hold, the wondrous revealed. And so what he would teach, and a lot of the teaching, had to do with some very ordinary, everyday emotions, behaviors, feelings, thoughts that weren't profound and in the realm of prajnaparamita, but really just who we were as persons. And his point was, who you are as a person is basically an entangled Buddha. You've taken your Buddha nature and turned it into this mass of attachments and thoughts and feelings and whatnot that are in many, many ways just off, not clear, not straight. And the only way to get that is to work through them one by one, individually, even the ones where the hardest to recognize. And that's where all of the attention then got focused on our teaching. So I was telling somebody the other day, they say, oh, it must have been wonderful to study under Master Hua and to be with him. And I go, yeah, but it was also difficult, very, very difficult. We're reading a passage of, if you want to become awakened and truly accomplish the way, first and foremost, says Manjushri to Sudana, you must find and follow a Shanjushir, a Kalyana Mitra, a good and wise advisor. And somebody says, oh, it's really a bummer. We don't have any good and wise advisors anymore. They're all gone. They're extinct. And you were so lucky to have one. And I said, well, yeah, yes and no, because to be in the presence of a good and wise advisor, as you can imagine, is both edifying, enlightening, and also just messy and difficult and frustrating. Because what the good advisor is doing is actually working on you therapeutically as a physician and working on those areas and spots that aren't healthy. So it's not about praise and, you know, saying, oh, you know, just imagine Guanyin Bodhisattva sitting on a lotus or something. It's more like, if you don't get rid of your jealousy, you're never going to get anywhere. And your anger is just, you know, and your greed and your arrogance. And he would actually set up situations where these would manifest and come out. I mean, in a sense of trying to heat the water up so things would come to a boil. So instead of just sitting, if you really wanted to sit, he would interrupt your sitting. If you wanted to speak in front of people in public, he would not call on you. And if you didn't want to, he would call on you all the time. if you were really trying to break your attachment to sugar, he would make sure that there was lots of it almost every day on the table for you. If you were trying to break your attachment to fame, he would set you up to perform, you know, to sing Dharma songs in front of, you know, a great assembly someplace. Anything to bring out those hidden, latent afflictions, tendencies, so that you could see them, first of all, and by seeing them, hopefully recognize their foolish absurdity and let go of them. Whereas my normal behavior was to cover these over and pretend they weren't there. So he didn't let that happen. My friends let that happen. So hanging out with my friends, they just reinforced all those things. But what he did was to rub the fur the wrong way, is an expression I like to use, because when I was a kid on the farm, there was a cat, and the cat was always scratching me. And my uncle finally said, it's because you don't know how to pet the cat. And I said, what do you mean? And I showed him I was petting the cat. I'd come up behind the cat and pet the cat, moving its fur that way. And the cat would just turn around and then scratch the heck out of me. And then my uncle, he said, now watch. And he would start from the head and go backwards. And then pretty soon you hear this, and the cat would roll over and purr. And I said, well, why? What's different? He says, you're going against the grain. And so I took this metaphor example to be exactly what my teacher was doing to me. He was petting me against my fur. Instead of petting my fur, so I go, so nice, it's just like the Buddha, it's so mellow. He was constantly rubbing the fur the wrong way and creating this. And then when you'd stern and snarl and, you know, and go, shit, and then just hold the mirror up and say, huh, what do you see? And so I'm giving you both metaphorically, but this was very real. So to be in his presence was not all that good. And Hung Shir and I used to laugh and people would say, so you, when the master came to wherever you were, and sometimes you can see this in the photos, everybody's happy and their hands are together and they're bowing and whatnot. But the child inside, the child that is not awakened, is going, he's here, you know, he's going to rub my fur the wrong way. But you were trying to be nice and polite and hoping that he was in a good mood. So this is what you thought, that this was determined by his moods. So if he's in a good mood, he wouldn't rub you the wrong way, but if he was in a bad mood, then you got it. It had nothing to do with his moods. His moods were completely, I didn't see what his moods were, because everything he manifested was a therapeutic teaching in response to us and not a manifestation of a personal mood. So what happened often is we would hide out. We'd try to come to lunch late and split early. We'd try to sit in the back of the hall like tonight, because if you sat in the front, you thought, well, maybe he's older, his eyes are getting bad, he won't see me back here. So we'd wear a lot of clothes and get in the back, and we'd sit there and hope. And they'd say, oh, yeah, come up and talk a little bit, speak a little dharma for people. And then you would come up and and think, okay, it's my turn. I should speak dharma, because he says, if you don't speak dharma, you shouldn't eat, because you're at the monastery, you're accepting food as blessings, but what do you give in return? Nothing. So you have to give dharma in return for offering. So lecture a little. So you might begin lecturing by saying, in the ninth chapter of the Avatamsaka Sutra, the Bodhisattva of illness, grace, and ease, and that, what do you know about that? Why don't you tell about how you stole that thing once and got in trouble? Why don't you talk about how you really had a hard time breaking up with your girlfriend to come to the monastery? Why don't you talk about that time that, you know, something about your parents? So he would take the concrete things of your life, and then you'd talk about them, but then you'd wrap it into a dharma principle at the end. And so he was always putting you in these situations to talk what you knew and talk true. Anyways, one of the things we would do in the meditation process, and that's where I was going roundabout tonight, was you can sit quietly in meditation and learn the practice, and ultimately, if the mind is really still and calm, this wondrous thing manifests by itself. It's quite true, and that's why the Sharangama Sutra says, when the mad, busy mind stops, that very stopping is bodhi. It's not like something that happens after that, but it's simultaneous with it. So part of stopping the mad mind is just an exercise, and one of the first things he would teach us to do was not to be worried and upset by what came up. So when you sit like this and your eyes slightly open, thoughts, feelings, emotions, memories, dreams, reflections, bad memories, good memories, worries, concerns, anxieties, fantasies, you know, all this stuff is just there, right? Well, you say right, otherwise I think I'm the only one doing that. And there. Okay, so it's all there. And he said, don't worry about it. He said, it's like when light comes into a room and you think the room is really nothing in the air, but when the sunlight comes in, all of a sudden you see all the dust that's been there all the time, but you never saw it before. When you sit, you're returning the light to see the dust. And he says, then you have to let the dust settle. So don't stir it up by getting upset that that's all there. And don't stir it up by trying to push the dust down. Because if you've ever tried to do that, dusting, nobody dusts anymore. They have servants who do it or what, I don't know. But if you do dusting, you notice if you do a lot of activity, it just stirs the dust up again. So the way you just let the dust, it'll settle by itself if you don't move. So the first thing he would teach us was, don't get upset, don't try to repress. He'd say, with a calm, impartial mind, just observe the rise and fall of all these things. That was the first stage. Just observe the rise and fall of all these things. Then later, and that's probably where I'll get a little bit tonight, we would actually get a little more technical. And the text would ask you to look into those things that you're grasping and attaching to. In other words, don't simply say, I'm not going to grasp and attach to this, but actually analyze it a little bit and ask, what is this that I'm grasping and attaching to? And he would begin this teaching to us by saying, first of all, you should realize there is nothing you can grasp and attach to. So it's actually, I'm not speaking correctly when I say let go, release your hold, because in fact, you can hold on and grasp anything. And all of a sudden, you know, you started to think, well, the grasping and attaching is actually imaginary. It seems real, but it's actually imaginary because there isn't anything one can grasp and hold on to. And already that's a liberating insight. But it's, again, counterintuitive because Han Shan in the passage we'll read next week talks about the fundamental problem is we can't stop grasping. We cannot stop wanting, craving, grasping, desiring. It's almost like so habitual, so second nature that it's impossible to even catch when we're doing it, much less stop doing it. And if you look at most human activity, it's a constant, ceaseless grasping, attaching, wanting, craving, acquiring, and fearing losing. Even in sleep. Sleep is just, in dreams, it's just another extension of this. It's almost comical if it weren't at the same time sort of tragic. And so this fundamental, but what he was saying was, and yet everything you grasp and reach out for, where is it? You can't get it. And then he quoted a passage from the Avatamsaka Sutra where one of the disciples said, you have taught us to not grasp, not to graha. Isn't graha in Sanskrit? Yeah. It's actually the root of that. Yeah, graha. Sanskrit is graha. Grab. That's where the English word comes, grab. Yeah, take, grab. And the Buddha said, no, I didn't teach you that. And the disciple was, well, what do you mean you didn't teach it? She said, non-grasping was it. He said, well, I only said that as a trick because, in fact, there's nothing you can grasp. So what is there to let go of? And at that moment, that disciple got awakened. And I was going, wait a minute. I went back and tried to do the math on that again because I was convinced that there was something I could get. So even when I went into the monastery and I left behind all these things, all these worldly things, let them go, you know, so where's my Bodhi? And then start grabbing for spiritual states, signs of accomplishment, my merit and virtue is bigger than yours, and so forth. And so you started the same mind, but now in the shopping mall of spiritual things. So my robe was not as good as his robe. My beads were not as nice as his beads. You know, she sits longer than I do. And the grasping, comparing, competing mind then just started to whip around in the temple. And in a sense, it was good because in that small arena, it really starts to look absurd. You know, but in the larger world, it seems normal. So then he would take us through, and I'll just mention these tonight, what are called the four foundations of mindfulness. And this is actually a list. It's a list that's used in beginning and stages of meditation. It's at the core of shamatha vipassana meditation. And what you do is you actually get a little more analytical here. And you actually look at it. What is it that I identify with? What is it and where do I set up and claim to have something I hold on to grasp? And you begin a process of what they call using the three marks to look at these four things. And this is a beginning stage of meditation. I'll just mention tonight. Anybody know what these three marks are? These three marks are sort of what define all phenomena. In other words, the characteristic that all phenomena have. But it's also then a lens you use to bring into focus all things. So one is called anitta, anatta, and dukkha. These are called the three marks. And anitta means, impermanent, passing, not stable, shifting, in flux, not lasting, always contingent. It's like Heraclitus said, you can never step into the same river twice because the river is just moving and moving and moving. So you put your foot in, pull out, going back again, it's a different molecule, it's different. So that flux of things is, everything is this way. That's the first mark. And that in itself becomes one of the meditation tools or topics you can use. You begin your meditation, you calm and you quiet, but your meditation topic is what is permanent? What does not change? And then you do calming, you sit for a while, until you get really settled, and then you look into this, and then you come back again. And you go back and forth, you begin an investigation to ask, what does not change? What's the answer? What? See, well, I haven't looked into it, but I'm sure there's something. If you're a smart ass, you say, well, change is the only constant. You know, okay, right. Change is the only thing that's permanent. But if you look at it, and you start to look at it both from a scientific point of view, which is really cool, you go down to the micro level, microphysical level, and you see everything is in motion. So even as we're sitting here, the floor, this is everything is in some kind of field of motion, even though it might seem solid to us. And then you go up to the largest, which are the planets and the stars and everything in between, and there's everything is in flux and change. It's a constant. Then you go to anatta, and that means no self, or literally nothing is self-existing. Everything is dependent on something else. Nothing is just eternally that by itself, but arises and changes and shifts with the conditions. And the third one, dukkha, well, technically suffering, but it's really psychologically much more. Suffering is the result of dukkha. And suffering is a kind of angst or dissatisfaction you feel faced with the other two. So because everything's impermanent and nothing is self-existing, is self-abiding, this is really unsatisfactory. There's dukkha that arises because where am I going to set up and claim something here? So this anxiety, sometimes monks have translated the dukkha as stress. Very interesting. The stress or anxiety that arises from the observation of things as they seem to be in their real state, not past the fantasy, past the movies, you know, past all that sort of thing. As you really look at things raw, they are anitta and anatta. Okay? This produces dukkha. But dukkha then is the ground from which the Buddha came. That begins his investigation. He says, okay, I'm calling it real, it's like this. Where do we go from here? And you could go into despair or empty nihilism, or you could sort of say, is there anything beyond this? And the beginning of the path of cultivation that Buddha pursued was stimulated by this intensely raw realization of dukkha. So he then developed the four mindfulnesses that he taught to some disciples. He taught different things to different people. And now people call them schools and traditions and isms and things, but just forget that, you know. He was just saying, like, I think I can teach you a little bit about quieting your mind. I am going to have to teach you a little bit about patience, and you, I'm going to have to teach about stinginess. And whatever your major obstacle was, he taught, and everybody thought the Dharma's about ending stinginess. Well, yes, it is about that for you, but each one had a different, you know, anyhow. So the four mindfulnesses, he said, there's four areas where we apply this. One is the body. So basically, get my help with my Sanskrit, it's rupa, vedana, citta, and dharma. Yeah, these are the four. So rupa means the physical body. That's where you begin your investigation of anitta, anatta, and dukkha. What's this? What is this thing? And the first attachment one has is to this body. This is where we set up house, okay? So, you know, the world can go to hell, but this thing we're going to take care of, right? This is the thing that goes to the health club. It's the thing, it's all the organic good food. It's the stuff that gets the vaccination, you know, because you're going to keep this thing in shape. And most of the news and the ads on television tonight about losing your body. You ever watch? I mean, seriously, if you look at the ads, it's about losing it or preserving it or making it prettier, better, or stronger, or, you know, healthier or whatnot. It's never about losing it. Now that I've turned 60-whatever, in the mail once a week I get, don't wait, plan ahead. Mortuary, mausoleum, and, you know, it's like, do our layaway plan, you know. It's like, right? You're going, wait a minute, why am I getting all this? Because I'm at that stage where now they're talking about the body going. Before that was, buy this, take that, get testosterone injections, you know, work out, go to the health club, join the YMCA, you know, blah, blah, blah. Now that I'm 65, I'm starting to get like, okay, let's get real. You know, choose your coffin. Oh, no, and there's the good one is, Get it now today, lock in the price, because you know there's inflation. Oh, right, I'm going to really, just in my last breath, I'm going, inflation, wow. And then I die. No, so the first contemplation, some people say the contemplation is you regard the body as impure, but what impure means, it doesn't mean just, oh, beyond the skin. Those of you who have seen the body beyond the skin, anybody here without going macabre? Right, the body beyond the skin. If you've ever done the dissections in biology or have ever come upon a hospital surgery, you know it's not a great smelling, yeah, it's a mess. It's a mess. And anyhow, but it means that. It's sort of to break your attachment to the artificial sense of it being, you know, the kind of Taj Mahal, okay? But it also, impure also has a more profound metaphysical meaning. It means it's not unalloyed. It is not something unto itself that is impermeable and not subject to a multiple mixture of stuff. So pure means not so much the sense of dirty, but the sense of something that has no admixture, 99.9%, you know, gold or something like that. So then you contemplate, yes, it is a mixture. You start to see that it's a mixture of all these things, the food you eat, the water you take in, all the various fluids and whatnot. And so you actually do a contemplation of the body that way. Now, another level of this contemplation is you go through the other two. You go through its impermanent nature and also its non-self nature, which gets to be a little tricky because you're thinking, no, this is me. Dang it, this is my body, me. And then you start to think, though, but it gets old. It changes. The hair falls out. The skin goes away. Parts stop working. You replace them. You know, like my body's me, except for I got two huge metal titanium replacements here keeping my legs on. So are they me or not me? I was figuring, you know, when I die, they'll cremate my body, and then someone will say, oh, my God, look at that huge sharira. And it'll just be a titanium hip. Anyhow, so you start to look at that and you realize that the body really is subject to this impermanence and whatnot. And so you start to let go of identity of saying, I am my body. The next thing that happens is then you go to the other three, which is Vedana, Citta, and Dharma. So these have to do more with the mind. So you say, well, I'm not my body. Everybody knows that. My power, my identity, myself, my soul, whatever you say it, is in my mind. I realize the body comes and goes, but this mind of mine is eternal, right? And when then we mutate it into an idea of a soul, yeah. And so this becomes this inner, indescribable entity called the mind or the soul, and that's where I reside. And even though this passes, I will go off to be reborn in a heaven or to get another body. But that's the real me. So then the second one is, this is made up of feelings. So Vedana has to do with feelings, sensations. And so you start to look through those. And this one says feelings are dukkha. They're unsatisfactory because they're so inconstant, ever in change, ever. You never can nail them down. Suffering turns to joy, but joy can turn to suffering. Happiness turns to displeasure. Displeasure can turn to happiness. Gain turns to loss. Excitement turns to boredom, and so forth. It's just like they're constantly a source of dissatisfaction because anitta and anatta again, and you can never just hold on to them, and you can't control them, and they seem to come and go at whim, and through a day you've gone through how many feelings, and then they're gone again. So then you go to citta, which is, how do you translate? It's mind or thoughts. It's mind, but it's also what the mind does. So it's all your thoughts, ideas, deeper impressions. Your fantasies are in the mind. What else? It's a repository of just about everything. It's and that is called, you look at the mind as, body's impure, dukkha. Thoughts are impermanent. That's their fundamental characteristic. And this is what you see in meditation. In fact, they've done neurological things now where they try to get people to tune into a train of thoughts they have while they're meditating. And even the most advanced meditators can't go beyond two or three before they can't remember what the thought was that preceded that. And sometimes they're compared to the waves that break on the shore. One wave breaks and you're watching that one, and then another one breaks, and then a third one, and you can't remember, and just wave after wave, they're impermanent. So when you sit in meditation, you're there and you go, thought, 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 feeling, idea, insight, impulse, bum, 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 bum. And an hour passes, they ring the bell, and you'd say, okay, now take me back through what you just did there. Whoa, can't get it. It's so fast, so fleeting. There's nothing stable there. And yet, that activity makes us feel that we're conscious, directing, analyzing, and control, when it's just really just like a freeway at rush hour. And so then the last one is dharmas, or dhamma. And this doesn't mean the Buddha dharma. This means, this is hard to translate. Some people translate it as phenomena, but what they mean by that is the construction of a reality that's based on your sense organs, looking at sense objects and creating a pattern or creating a meaning to it. So eyes observe forms and then define them in certain ways. Ears do this with sound. So it's a discriminating construction of sense objects with our sense organs, creating this realm that we call the real world. But in fact, it's a constant interacting, shifting play of setting up consciousness, attachment, definition. It's dharmas. Yeah, they use dharmas. And it means the phenomenological creation of the 18 realms. I mean, in other words, consciousness in between objects and the organs. And so what we call the real world, what we say, hey, that's there, that's really there, it's different for all different people because consciousness makes these things different for, right? So it's like one of the texts refers to this, that different living beings come upon a body of water. But for different living beings, the body of water is something else. For some, it's a beautiful crystal pool of something. For others, it's a threat because water drowns them. For others, it's life because they live in the water. And so water is water, but what it is different to all the different living beings. This is one part of the text. But you can see this in a more just a mundane way of you go home one day and you look at something in your house, a person perhaps, and they, well, if you live with persons, this opens up a wonderful term of contemplation. You come and you say, dear, I'm home. Wow, you look great, I love you. And then you go back out and something happens, she or he does something that really upsets you. Or you do something that really upsets you and come home and it's like, get out of my face. The person, based on emotions and feelings, actually looks different to you. Well, have they changed? No. The dharma has changed because the consciousness in between the object and the thing has changed. So what the Buddha is saying, everything's made from mind alone. What he means by this is we are constructing constantly through the filters of our feelings, thoughts, ideas, and so forth, the actual real world out there. And so as a result, we can adjust and acclimate to all kinds of things without realizing it's happening. Something like global warming. You know, we just, and it's not there. We just adjust. This is called hedonic adaptation, by the way. There's an actual psychological term for that, and that means we reach a point of saturation, and then we tire and get bored and need to up it or change it or whatnot. So we can never be satisfied with constancy. Hedonic means pleasure saturation. So when we get an object and we find, ah, okay, within minutes sometimes, the adaptation sets in, a kind of saturation, and then it's no longer satisfying and pleasing. We need something else. Yes. Living beings grasping everywhere. Anticipation. Anticipation. Expecting. Wanting. And so the newness, the promise of this, stimulates this mind to be in a constant cycle, and that's what this constant craving, excitement, grasping, and attaching is. And the irony of this, at the end, there's nothing that we've gotten. We just use all this activity, the body, feelings, thoughts, dharmas. We're constantly schlepping, if you want to use that word. I love that word, schlepping. It's like Costco, big cart. You're schlepping, you're filling it up, you know, and you fill your cart up, and when you go out, you realize it was all a hologram. There's nothing in the cart, except they took your money. This is called when in the Buddhist meditation tradition, your jingxian, your energy has gone. You thought you got by grasping, but what happened was a reverse exchange. You've lost your vital energy, the vital energy you need to generate the light to see things as they really are. So this process is one of the psychological ways of rendering samsara. Samsara is the psychological process of doing these things constantly, not having a handle on it. And day after day, the text says, day after day, week after week, year after year, thus the life passes. This frantic passage through life, says the sixth patriarch, then ends in a bitter regret. Because only at the end do you realize, empty-handed. And so I told you, I'll finish with the story of my teacher. This happens when I ramble, so anyhow. But you got something here. So he said, it's like a bear in a cornfield. And he says, the bear goes in the cornfield, and it sees an ear of corn. And it picks up this ear, grass of the ear of corn, you know, and but then sees another one. So instead of just enjoying that ear of corn, the bear says, well, so it sticks it under his arm like this and goes and picks up another one. Now he's got two, but he sees a third ear of corn. So he says, I want that one too. So he reaches out, grabs the third ear of corn, but that one falls out. And he puts it under this armpit. So you can see the pattern. So my teacher was saying, so he goes through the field in his mind. He has this ear of corn, ear of corn, ear of corn. And when he gets out, he still only has one in his hand because all the others. And then he said, everything that you go after and you pick up is this way. And in the end, you're lucky if you have one. So at that time, I was sort of thinking, I wonder what the application is. And then, because I was in graduate school at the time, so he says, it's sort of like scholars with their books, huh? He says, well, they go and they get one book and they read it. And then they get another book and they read that one. But then they can't remember what they read in the first one. Then you get a third book and they can't remember what they read in the first two. And he said, they go through this, like they go through 20 books, and then come back to the first one. They go, wow, this is a wonderful book. I wonder why I never read it before. And he said, in the same way, whatever you're attached to follows this pattern. He says, for some of you, it's relationships. Huh? Oh, you have this relationship, it's fresh, it's exciting, it's new, you're in love forever, it's old, stale, something's wrong, and you have another one. And the pattern repeats, and the pattern repeats, and the pattern repeats. These sort of multiple, continuous things. He said it could be cars, it could be relationships, it could be books. All dharmas are this way. So it was, what I'm getting at was, the teaching that we were getting was an actual analysis of what it is that we grasp at and need to let go of. It was a kind of, you deconstruct these things, and by doing that, you let them just fall by themselves, and then the letting go happens naturally as you see through them and put them down. But you have to do this a little bit. You can't just say, oh, I'm gonna let go of everything. You gotta really get specific. The devil's in the details. So wherever you are grasping at attaching, and it's usually shown by, how do you know? Because that's where you get excited or you get frustrated. That's where everything arises, right around those points. You know, I can put down something and say, look at him, he can't see through and put that down. You know, and he can see what I can't see through and put down. So we're good at spotting it in other people. Look at how upset he got when he didn't get the attention he wanted. Look what happened to her when, ha ha. We use it in that kind of way. But to turn it around and actually see where it is that we get dukkha, where we get the dissatisfaction, the angst, is exactly the gate that we get liberated through. And that's why the teacher constantly put us in the most uncomfortable places. In fact, Frank, remember we were doing dukkha, and you, one of the terms for dukkha, an early metaphor is, yeah, but the axle of the wheel, but there's a little, right, so it doesn't move, it clunks. It's like a wheel that's just slightly out of alignment. And when it turns, it clunks, you know. So in your life where you feel that, that's the point to pay attention to, because that's where actually it's out of alignment. So dukkha, in another sense, can mean out of alignment.
Everything that you just described to me, if this does reveal my vanity, I suppose, it sounds selfish, right? It sounds, everything that you describe, like going to Costco and everything you put in, you know, the bear who grabs the corn, it's all a kind of reaching out for personal gratification and building a sense of self. Meaningless sort of tasks for the self. Where does sort of the mutual projects of civilization that we all also engage in, whether we're conscious of it or not, we're all working on a common project to build something that's greater than ourselves, because we're living in this society and we're building this civilization as we go. Where does that fit in? I mean, it doesn't seem to fit in completely into a selfish, narrow scheme of things or outlook. It's something greater than the self, but I recognize that it too is impermanent. And it, you know, you could probably apply all of those sort of critiques, if you would, that you just applied to all those selfish interactions also to the interaction with civilization or society. So how do you...
No, it's a good question. There's a couple things to remember. I just throw out a couple concepts. One is sufficiency enough is a marker. I just throw out a couple markers. One is knowing when it's enough. Too little is, you know, you're saying, oh, I'm the minimalist. Well, that's another form of setting it up. You know, you get rid of everything, and you go, I'm more minimal than you are. You have two rooms, I have one. You know, you have two outlets, I have one. You have one outlet, I have none. I'm going off the grid. You know, well, you can get into that, but it's still the same mind that's setting up an identity through that.
Yeah.
So knowing when to stop, the text says, never in danger. The problem is we don't know when to stop, and therefore we invite disaster. So sufficiency is one measure you use. Is growth development.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So the next level you ask then, with all this stuff we're doing, quality-wise, not quantity-wise, what is it advancing? Is it advancing the best qualities of human nature? Getting along, sufficiency, equitable, harmony, compassion, kindness, and a environment for awakening to occur in a healthy, creative way, including arts and science and everything else.
Right.
Or is it driven by... what we would call selfishness, self-benefit, self-seeking, which is really another way of saying anxiety. You know, that anxiety is more descriptive. Selfishness is judgmental.
Yeah.
Because behind selfishness is a nervous anxiety. Behind our activity isn't this kind of ravenous greed. That's not what's driving us. It's the anxiety, the angst from the dukkha. And so we're trying to desperately do something. It's more pathos than it is, you know, amoral. And if you look at it that way, you get more therapeutic. Because what are you going to do when you say, you're selfish? Well, where do you go with that?
Right.
But you say, you're grasping and grabbing and trying to acquire because basically you're really afraid. You're afraid that everything is passing, and it's true. But beyond that, if you can let go of that fear, there's something quite wondrous coming to terms with it. So there's different ways to come at it, but it doesn't stop activity, but it asks you, what is this activity for? You know, you do the longer thing, and then you ask, when is enough? When is zhu is Chinese, zhu chang le is a four character. knowing when to stop or knowing enough, one is always content, happy, full of joy. And then Lao Tzu says the opposite. When you don't know, there's no sign of greater impending disaster than always wanting more, and there's no sign of tragedy than not knowing when to stop. So it doesn't mean that you don't do, but it means how do you do, why do you do, for whom do you do, and what's the result of what you're doing? And so there's a kind of creative openness here, but at the same time, a critical assessment of acting, looking at intention and motivation.
It just reminds me, what you're saying reminds me of, you know, how we sort of, what we were told when the wars that are going on right now started was, you know, go out and shop. You know, keep the economy rolling, because the economy is what's creating the surplus that allows us to fight these wars, right? And it's the same thing with everything, even science and art. We're all encouraged to do what we can do for our own self, and generating income for the self, because that generates surplus for society to do arts and science and gain knowledge and have leisure time and fight wars and all these things. So it's striking to me right now that the kind of conundrum that we are encouraged to just do what you want for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Generate as much surplus as you can, and somebody will use that surplus.
And that's not a hard thing, not a hard thing. The Buddha would say that's not a hard thing to encourage, because it's already a flame.
Yeah,
throw
right.
a little gas on that one. Go ahead and do what you want and do what you feel. Oh, really?
Yeah. Set it up in a way that it's really easy just to roll with that.
It's very easy to roll with that. It's very easy to entice people with that. But it's very hard to turn it back once it gets rolling. Your hour here on Friday night, hour and a half on Friday night, is very bad for the economy. Okay, so you guys are really, really drag anchors on the economy. First of all, while you're here, you're not doing anything. You're not even plugged in, hopefully, except people have heart pacers or something. That's okay. So you're not plugged in. You're not buying. You're not consuming. You're not looking at anything. You're not getting excited. And then you're listening to this stuff that's reinforcing that. So you're actually going out not stirred up to buy, consume, and be frantic. So again, the Buddha would say, do not simply follow the crowd, but think for yourself. Listen to yourself. Feel yourself. The best read of where you want to go or where you are is listening to yourself. The answer is right there. Know yourself what it means to be happy, to know enough. Trust that, you'll be fine. It's not trusting and listening to yourself that we go astray. Hence the famous Jataka story, which I won't relate tonight, that you all know. The sky is falling, the sky is falling. The Chicken Little story is actually a Jataka tale, right? And I forget, who's the little character? Is it the monkey? Yeah, the monkey. Those who are monkeys should think. The monkey, how do the monkeys around a tree looking for something? And then something falls, goes clunk, and splits open. And monkey jumps, and monkey says, oh my gosh, the universe, the sky, because they saw the size of the ceiling, it's cracked and it's falling. And monkey does a couple backflips, gets all excited, and goes running, runs into lion. And lion says, hey man, where are you going? He says, Get, go, move quick, the sky's falling. The sky's falling. The lion says, really? He roars, sky's falling. So the antelope, the giraffe, all these animals, everybody's running, and they're all running. This whole parade, the parrots and everything squawking, and finally they get to the Buddha sitting beneath his tree, going, And it's like, and he said, what are you doing? Oh, you got to move, the sky's falling. And the Buddha looks and says, what's the problem? Everything's okay, no problem. No, it's, well, where did you hear that? Well, and the antelope says it, you know, the lion, the monkey. So the Buddha takes the monkey by the hand and says, let's go back to see where that sky fell. So they go back together. You can see there's a little monkey going back and all the animals falling. And the Buddha says, where is it? There it is. And he picks it up, and basically it's one of those, what is it, fruits. Yeah, it's one of the fruits that grow in the tropical areas, whether, I don't know, like a papaya or something, you know. And the Buddha picks up and he says, look at this carefully, see it for what it really is, blah, blah, blah. And the monkey, end of story. But the Buddha uses story to say, we in the process of life, he used this story to indicate how we follow false spiritual teachers. But he meant it as a larger story, how we get caught up in the rush and the flow, never stopping to pause, and actually submerging our own native feelings and intuitions, denying them, repelling, pushing those down, even to the point where we'll ruin our bodies and our minds in ill health, pursuing these things. When every sign and indicator is there and we just ignore it for the sense that we are in the move, we're in the flow, we're going with things, and we're da 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 da. So part of what meditation does is it unplugs you for 45 minutes on a Friday night to just be able to listen to yourself and take stock. Pretty good. Anyhow, I won't do this anymore. I just thought tonight, a Friday night, we don't have to dive right into the text. We'll start with a little background. Then next week, we'll go back to Han Shan and continue. And Han Shan is now in the part of the text he's going deep into the garbage can and saying, by the way, you need to pull this out, you need to pull that out, you need to pull that out. So. Well, it's funny because I was thinking, I don't have anything to say tonight. What am I going to do? And I thought, well, what I'm going to say is, y'all want to sit for 45 minutes more? Let's go back. So anyways, welcome back. We'll be continuing every Friday night. Any announcements need to be made? Anything coming up?
Tomorrow?
I should say, even though it's not part of my real tradition, but I don't know what my... Happy New Year. Okay, so today is New Year's by a good part of the population throughout the world. January 1st for others. For the enlightened teacher, every day is Happy New Year's. I told you this story before. It's really wonderful. We would try to ingratiate ourselves with our teacher, thinking if we ingratiate ourselves with the teacher, when he was scolding and making others falls, come and say, oh, you're really good. So one of the ways we thought to ingratiate him was to give him birthday presents, except we never knew exactly. He's an older Chinese man, and they didn't keep very good records. We never knew exactly what his birthday was. But we had a pretty good guess. So one of the monks who really wanted to be great and ingratiated thought, it's auspicious if I'm the first one to wish him happy birthday. Everybody else of that is an echo. So he got up like at 3 a.m, because we started at 4. He stood by the stairs where the master would come down, you know, like a cat ready to spring. And so the morning, the way we wake up in the morning is this sound. So you're sleeping, it goes. You're sleeping and someone walks down the hall and does that. No alarm clocks, that's it. Now, I was at the City 10,000 Buddhas, and they got a new novice doing it. And the novice is just, hi. okay. Everything points to the mind. So the master's coming down the stairs, and this monk comes up and says, happy birthday! It's like, and the master's like, whoa. And then he just very calmly turns to me and says, every day I'm happy, every day is my birthday, and just walks on. The monk goes like, did I win that one or not? So anyways, Happy New Year.
Mark, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Because you say you got a school.
Spare the rod, spoil the child. Okay, so this is a very good question. Very good question. Why don't I scold you? First of all, I don't think I'm a teacher, but that beside the point. When I did think I was a teacher, that was the first thing I did. So I saw this method my teacher used, and I thought, wow. You know, he scolds you. He says, well, you're always coming in late. You don't care about the Dharma. You're always grabbing the best food at lunch. You're such greedy. How can you ever get in line? You think, everywhere you scold. When you lecture, you sound like a frog croaking. You talk about insignificant things like four frogs have eight eyes. Blah. He would say things like that. It's just like all the time. One time we're traveling with the master, and we're in the airplane going to Hong Kong. And it's a flight, and you're thinking, oh, I shouldn't watch the movie. I'm trying to cultivate and not watch this sexy, violent movie on the screen in the airplane. And then, you know, I'm doing this back and forth, and I look over, the master's like watching me. But he's smiling. He's at ease. You know, he says, not easy, is it? And then the food comes, and we just get a little bit. We were eating only one meal a day. It was a long flight. So the food comes, it's just a little bit, and we didn't get enough. And we thought, well, if we ask for more, it's going to be greed, so it would just be enough. But we're really hungry. And then they bring in the second meal, and we thought, oh, we can't. And the master says, okay, everybody eat. He says, you go out the door, you'd be expedient. Oh, no problem. Wow, it's going to be a great trip. And then we land in Hong Kong, and it's night and day, Jekyll and Hyde. He just starts scolding nonstop. He scolds the disciples there to greet him. He says, oh, you're coming out to bow to me. Why are you coming to bow to me? Because you think by bowing to me, you'll get rich and wealthy. Ha! You know, he walks by them. And he says, you're bowing to me, but last night you lost all your money gambling. Now you want me to, you know, blah, blah, blah. Oh, man, he's just scolding. And I'm turning around, he's scolding everybody, he's scolding me. He said, now you watch that stupid movie and you can't get your head straight on, you lost the luggage. And it's like, mama. So we go there, we have the lecture hall, and there's like 500 or 600 people every night, and he's just stern and scolding and whatnot, and they keep coming back, you know? And then when it's over, we go to the room and he scolds us some more, you know? And so finally, at this time, he decided he hadn't been back to his home place in Dongbei, in Manchuria, and so he sort of secretly went into, took Hong Kong over, took the train and went into, traveled unannounced to Manchuria to see some of his relatives in his native place. And he said to Hung Shur and I, you guys take over and keep the lectures and everything going here and accept the offerings and whatnot. And so we thought, oh, yeah, really? Wow, we're ready. And so we got up there and it's like, scold you, and I scolded everybody. I was scolding them left and right. I was scolding them with such ease and such creativity. I mean, I can scold better than my teacher. Whoa! And on that, the next night there was like half that many people. And then the third night, half that many. And so after about a week, he came back, there were two old ladies there of the every night. And I thought, well, at least we kept two. And I'm sure he says, the only reason we kept them, he says, is they speak Cantonese and they don't understand you or me. And so then the master came back and he said, what's going on? And we said, well, we did what you said. We held down the fort, we caught Kanmun, we watched the door, and we gave lectures and taught Dharma. And we did what you did. What? We scolded people. And he says, how come when I scold people, they come back for more? And when you scold them, they run away and they never come back. I'm going, that's a good question. And he said, then he quoted this famous line, I'll never forget. So this line, it was from the Tao Te Ching. And he says, the apprentice carpenter should be careful not to pick up the sharp tools of the master lest he cut off his own hand. Huh? And so I was left to contemplate then, and I realized to be able to scold somebody, you really have to have everything in order. Or otherwise, it just turns out to some kind of venting, some personal thing, and it isn't really skillful. And one of the best examples I know of this was he used to scold Hung Shur severely, and he would just gently, you know, ping me, and I would be in tears. And but Hung Shur, he could scold. He said Hung Shur was like a Michelin tire. He could run over gravel and rocks and bounce back and be unfazed. So he could brutally scold him, and Hung Shur, you know, he would just sort of take it. So one time Hung Shur was here on his side, and I was on this side, And he was scolding Hung Shur, and it was like, wow. And everybody was looking. He was on the high seat. How come you're not? And he's going like this, and Hung Shur's got his head down, but, you know, just sort of taking it. I'm going, wow, the teacher's really lost it. And he goes, rah, 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 and he goes, rah, rah, rah. So what he did is like he just turned and gave me a smile and went back. And I realized, wait a minute, this is not emotional outbursts that he's using. This is just another medicine he's applying, and he's not any more attached to this than giving praise. So then I thought, well, then when I get praise, is that real either? Anyhow, so I don't pick up the tools anymore. All I do is cut off my hand if I do. Okay, we'll do the transference in English. And do you have announcements? Because I mentioned.
Monday night, we have class with Doug Powers. The class is called Buddhism for the Modern Mind. And it's, you see a poster on the wall. And basically the intent of the class is to bring, you could say, interesting topics that face young people's lives right now and bring Buddhist texts to kind of inform them. So the format of it is 1 week Doug Powers, who comes here very regularly. You teach 1 week, and then the following week, Jing Hoshir and myself will lead the